I would like to start in the actual Corelight interface. Now, Corelight is, again, extracting Zeek logs from packet data to show the simplicity of how we get data into Splunk. It's a simple point-click integration with some, you know, identification of your server and the types of logs that you want or don't want to go into Splunk. So very simple integration, easy to set up, can be getting data into Splunk in minutes. I'd like to start in the Corelight app for Splunk. Now, what this shows you is extracted Zeek data in the format that a security analyst would start using it. So what you're seeing here is our homepage, and what you're seeing at the very forefront of the homepage are notable events. Now, these are triggered by our intel or notification framework, so intel being threat information and notification being essentially alerts. You're also noticing that we have built-in drill downs for these data types as well. So I'm going to click through and show you what these might look like in some more detail. We can expand the time frame out easily, and we can add filters easily using the Splunk interface. So you can see here, I have some very, very simple address hits on my Intel framework. So these are these are on my threat list, so they fire right away. In my notices dashboard, I'll expand that time frame out as well. We're actually able to look at notices over time. So we're looking for spikes here to identify a potential time frame of an issue. We're also looking at a breakdown of the types of notifications. So you can see here we have a bulk of SSL invalid server certificates. We also have some discovery attacks, long connections. There's some more detail found here in the chart below. Also, the raw logs are available in the bottom. So if you wanted to drill down into a specific log type, you could select an IP address as an example and put it here to further your search. Right? So this makes it very easy to look at the data types and look at the actual information going through the system. There's two workflows that we find all security practitioners go through. One is the interrogation of an IP address. So I'm going to start with that workflow. This is where you're given a breadcrumb from a user or from an alerting system. My IP address is not behaving normally. So let's take a look at what that IP address might show us. Now, in my example, I'm using a wildcard. So essentially, I'm doing an entire subnet analysis basically with a simple search. Now, I can cherry pick IP addresses to work from here. Let's see if we can grab 101. So we'll start with the 101 IP address and we'll start to see what type of information we can get from Zeek data in this interface. So you'll notice right away that 100% of this particular IP address is external, meaning they're communicating with the internet. Also, 100% of this traffic is web traffic. I have no non-web in use. So I can scroll down here and look for other information. I can also reverse my search. If I didn't find anything interesting or what I was looking for, I can actually go back to my broader subnet search and find a different breadcrumb to work off of. Let's see if we can pick on this 108 IP address. So let's see what he's doing. So again, no non-web protocol in use, some internal traffic, which is okay, about 3%, 96, 97% is all external. You can see here, he's getting some data from the internet, but the bulk of his traffic is encrypted, and he's using a single rare user agent, which is the apple.com. Down here is a catch-all for data sets that I might not have seen in the top widget. So you can see here I have some SSL traffic and some DNS traffic. So I'm going to drill into the SSL traffic to see if I can look for any interesting behavior. Now, as Ed mentioned, we do special analytics on encrypted traffic, and we identify misbehaving client SSL through JA3 hashes. So you can see here that I can readily identify bad behavior on SSL traffic when I see a JA3 hit. Very easy to use. Also, I'd like to point out, you can automatically see to the left here the hundreds of key value pairs that Ed mentioned previously. I'm actually going to show you what that looks like across the entire data set so you can see exactly the amount of KV pairs that we're getting. So you can see here, this is a substantial amount of data for threat hunters and incident responders to work with. Now, there's a couple of workflows that we see threat responders work with Zeek data on. The first is file analytics. So Zeek can natively export files. It also tracks files that it sees on the wire. So by that, I mean it creates a log file with metadata about the file itself, where the file came from, where the file went to, how the file was transferred, and if it can, it will determine the file name. So based on this data, we can build a special dashboard that will show the risk summary of files on the wire. So I'll let this load for a second. As you can see on the top left here, this is a very, very risky behavior. I've identified a file via the MIME type as an executable, right? So we know that this file is an executable. However, we also know that the file extension is a non-executable. So this is someone trying to hide an executable file on the wire to avoid detection. So we know right away that this puts us at high risk. In the next widget, we're looking for compressed files that are also trying to be hidden. And then down here at the bottom, we're actually looking for when files were transferred. So by looking at user patterns, I can determine if there's a high file transfer rate when there's no one in my office. Imagine, you know, your headquarters after 8 p.m. and before 8 a.m. If you see large spikes in file transfers, this is not likely a user. This is likely something going on behind the scenes. Now, there's a drill down into this dashboard. So we've identified the what is going on here. We've seen bad file behavior. Now we can start to look at the who, right? So again, we're extracting this from the Zeek data. So Zeek data is going to drill down from what the file behavior was to who exhibited that behavior. So right away on the top left here, who are the hosts that need to be remediated? So right here, identify right away, there are those files from my previous dashboard that ended up on this host. So from here, I may want to run drill down reports to see if those files were moved again, or if he executed those files, or I may want to just run virus scan on this user. Here, I can actually see where those came from. You can see that they were downloaded from the internet using the HTTP protocol. So now I may want to add these IP addresses to firewall restrictions or bad actors or threat lists. So I can now identify when I see other traffic to these IP addresses. So that's a very simple, easy to use file analysis workflow that even a tier one analyst can do. And you'll notice I haven't written a single search yet, actually. So I'm not deep into the Splunk language. So this is very easy for tier one and tier two analysts to work with. Now, we know that from recent news that DNS is a very risky protocol. So we've built a DNS threat hunting dashboard as well to look for anomalous or risky behavior in DNS. Now, you can see right away, we're looking for DNS requests with long queries. Now, this is clearly a query that you wouldn't normally see. So these are high-risk queries, 250 bytes in length or over 200 bytes in length. So we will want to drill into these and see if these were indeed malicious, or this can also be indicative of poor coding, a bad development issue here. If I scroll down, we're also looking for non-existent domains. This can become problematic if we see a lot of these. And then finally, responses with high answer counts. Even if you were to query some of the largest websites on earth, you know, Amazon.com or Google.com, you're only going to get returned four or five answers in a DNS lookup for those. Here you can see we're getting responses of answer counts over 50, and these are definitely going to be high risk when you see that many answers in a DNS query. So lastly, I want to run through some manual searching to show you the power of Zeek. So because Zeek is layer 7 aware, we can identify protocol use in your environment. So I'm going to start with the SSH protocol. So SSH is used by administrators to monitor administer devices, and it's also used for moving file transfers. SSH runs on the destination port 22 in a typical deployment, and I'm looking for, in this search, I'm looking for individuals trying to use SSH in my environment on the non-standard port. So obviously you can see I've found some. I can now scroll down and I can see where those destinations are, clearly the destination with the internet. I can also quickly identify where the sources were. And I can also identify very quickly my destination port. Reflect non-standard port here. So updated my search very quickly. Again, my destination port now becomes 27. My destination IPs are again on the internet. Now you can see this one is certainly a very high hit count. And then let's see if it's one individual or more, or multiple. So you can see here as well that it's primarily one or two individuals now, so I can identify quickly who's doing this behavior and possibly why. So why would I care about this? The potential risks are someone's managing a machine at their home, someone's developing code at their home, which is, of course, a compliance violation. Even more malicious, someone is exfilling data an offsite machine. So you can see right away here that you can use the protocol identification to look for people hiding things in plain sight in your environment. This is also useful for RDP. You could use this search. I won't execute these. I'll just show you examples of them. I could use a search like that. And even more prevalent, SMB. So SMB is a very risky protocol for data staging and data exfil. I can use a search, something like this, to show SMB traffic that's being hidden in my environment. So what's even better is we can actually identify directionality using Zeek data. So now I can start to determine if there are if there's data traffic being moved in my environment. So I can actually take my my SSH search that I used before and say, please show me if people are sending data out of my environment using the SSH protocol. So let's see if we can get something to load here. This will take just a moment. Oh, so no results found. That's pretty good. Let's see if people are downloading data. So I can actually use a different search that will actually show the downloading of data. And I'm going to expand this search just so I make sure I can get something valuable. All right. Ah. Bear with me. Ah, there we go. So you can see I modified my search to reflect the actual fields that are in the search, and you can start to see right away, have we downloaded any code here or any files? It very minimal, right? So that no risk there. I'm going to go ahead and run the upload again with the proper fields in it, and we'll see if we can catch anyone moving traffic outbound in my environment. This could be run across any protocol. It could be DNS, could be RDP, could be SMB. Those are huge red flags. Again, you can see not a lot of traffic here. If I round this up, I can actually pivot a little bit deeper into this to see if there was anything above the 0.0 gigabytes. Let's see if we had any, right? So again, not a lot of file transfers going on here. So very, very easy to determine how much traffic is being moved up and down. So this to me looks like benign, just administrative traffic. So with that, I'm going to end. You can see, obviously, the power of the Zeek data in the Splunk interface using not only the Corelight app for Splunk dashboards and the Corelight for Splunk app, but also in the raw Splunk search language.